My name is Rowan. I'm a PhD student at the University of Queensland, Australia. And my project is titled Magma Dynamics Recorded in Climate Pyroxene Megacrysts, Investigating the Destructive 1669 Eruption of Mount Etna. First, I'll just give some background to Mount Etna. It's the largest and most active volcano in Europe. It's located on the eastern coast of Sicily, the island that's being kicked by the boot of Italy. It's been erupting for about 500,000 years, and it's still erupting consistently almost every year. It produces both Strombolian eruptions and basaltic lava flows. Now, my project is focused on the 1669 eruption of Mount Etna, and you might be thinking, why bother studying an eruption that occurred 348 years ago when eruptions are occurring every year? Well, the significance of this eruption is that it was the most destructive event in Mount Etna's history. There are two types of eruptions in Mount Etna, summit eruptions and flank eruptions. This was a flank eruption that occurred low on the slopes of the volcano. It was unusually explosive, produced huge volumes of lava, and the lava came out very fast, flowing to the Mediterranean Sea and destroying the city of Catania. Mount Etna's lava compositions are very consistent. They usually contain clinopyroxene, olivine, plagioclase, and titanomagnetite. This project is focused on clinopyroxene. Large 1 cm crystals were found on the scoria cone from the eruptive site. And clinopyroxene is quite useful because it has slow chemical diffusion, which means its composition doesn't change much over time. It crystallizes across the entire crustal column, which means it records information from the source to the surface. And its changes in compositional zoning reflect changes in the melt from which it formed. So what we do is make these trace element maps and using laser ablation ICP-MS, and the color scales reveal complex compositional zoning. We look for compatible and incompatible elements. First we'll look at the incompatibles, the rare earth elements, and what they show us is that there are three distinct regions within the crystal, three magmatic environments: cores, mantles, and rings. And the cores vary between all the crystals, suggesting that they have varied magmatic histories, whereas the mantles and the rims are consistent in all of the crystals that we looked at. We can put some constraints onto the conditions in which these crystals formed. We do this by looking at the composition of the crystal as well as the melt in which it formed, and we can get an idea of this composition by looking at melting conditions which are included within the zones of the megacrysts. And what this has told us is that these crystals formed at temperatures of 1080 to 1180 degrees Celsius, and temperature and pressures corresponding to depths of 8 to 20 kilometers. And what's interesting about those temperatures is that they're much lower than the temperatures of magmas that we're seeing at Mount Etna today. In terms of compatible elements, we're particularly interested in chromium because chromium is known to be enriched in primitive melts, and we know that all of these crystals share a compositional rim which is rich in chromium, whereas the mantles are lower in chromium. What this suggests is that a magma rich in chromium was injected into a low chromium magma chamber shortly before the eruption. The rim is the last piece of crystal to crystallize, therefore this injection must have happened shortly before the eruption and could have triggered the eruption. Another interesting thing that we can figure out is how much time elapsed before this initial injection and the eventual eruption of magma. We can work this out by measuring the thickness of the rims and by knowing the growth rates of clinopyroxene, which are experimentally derived. And we can work out that there were 24 to 30 days elapsed between the initial injection and the eventual eruption of magma. And this ties in nicely to what we can use this information for in terms of present day volcano monitoring. What it tells us is that we know that eruptions can be triggered by magma recharge, and it also tells us that the most destructive eruption in Mount Etna's history was caused by a recharge event at 10 kilometers less than a month before the eruption. And this inform present-day volcano monitoring as to the types of signals we'll see in the future.